Hi, welcome to Almost Cooperstown.
I'm Mark.
And this is Gordon. And we love talking about baseball.
So we're doing our next deep dive, and it's kind of coming up in reverse order of World Championships 1. So far, we've done the Mariners, the Padres, and now we're going to do the Rays, and they have in common, they've never won a World Series.
They've made it there.
They have made it there, and they're a much better team. So here's the really interesting, I think, to start with the Rays that I find is really interesting. They were born the Tampa Bay Devil Rays. And I don't know if there was some scuttlebutt about the fact that the devil was in their name or something like that, but they, for the first 9 years of their existence, and they started the year after the Marlins won the 97 World Series, only in business for 4 years, the Rays came in on in 98, and in their first 9 years, they went 6-45 and 972 for a 399 winning percentage.
They were not very good.
They were terrible.
Which is even harder because they came in with another team. In the Arizona Diamondbacks, who were pretty much good right away.
Right from the start. Went to the playoffs in 99, went to the World Series and won it in 2001, so...
Not as much since then, but they got a World Series, which probably helps a lot.
So then some genius in Tampa, right, they say, you know what? It's the name. So we're going to drop Devil from our name. Dana Carvey, I think, comes to mind. The Devil. And the Tampa Bay Rays from 2008 to 2022 are 1,234 and 1,033 losses for a 544 winning percentage, 7 playoff appearances, and 2 pennants. So the moment that they changed their name, they won 7 playoffs, went to the playoffs 7 times in 14 years.
Now, immediately it started because they started making good trades right around this time. When they renamed themselves the Rays, ownership actually came out and said they were going to spend more money on the team, and they definitely started trying more to put a quality baseball product out. And pretty much right away it started turning around for them. They immediately started seeing dividends, you know, and turning into a less of a joke franchise. And now they've been, you know, a perennial fixture over the last 5 or 6 years at the top of the AL East.
Well, and before Joe Madden came. And so Joe Madden, I think, was a huge change for them because that the whole, you know, the way they played and the way they approached the game and always under-resourced, right? Would that be fair to say in terms of the Rays?
It felt like they were the new Oakland Athletics, where it was just like, they were sort of doing things their own way and they had their own way of looking at guys and how they played, and they're like, well, these guys work for us.
Well, and one of the things, and I've never been there, but you can talk about having been in that ballpark because I've never been in that ballpark.
Not a great place to watch a game, I will admit. It's not the most... The stadium, the people were as nice. We were a bunch of drunk college kids there to root on the Royals because I was with a bunch of guys from, you know, Missouri who were all giant Royals fans. So we were just there to be loud and obnoxious, and the fans were all... I think the Rays fans seemed to actually enjoy that there were other fans there kind of like watching and giving that atmosphere because they seemed to enjoy our antics more than anything else. So that was good. But I can imagine playing all of your games in that stadium would be a very odd experience.
And that's the only stadium they've ever played in.
Yeah, it's still the same stadium.
And this is their 25th anniversary season. Mm-hmm. So silver anniversary, and I'm sure the Rays came in this year with high hopes since they, you know, had a good team last year, didn't quite get there. And it's not necessarily going quite as well this year as they probably would have hoped, quite frankly.
No, I think they were hoping for, especially after last year and how good they were, and, you know, obviously they lost to the Red Sox in the ALDS last year, but I think they thought, okay, they were going to come back and be another contending team right up there with the Astros and the White Sox for the AL pennant. And injury and some other stuff, it just hasn't been their year this year.
And you know, when you think about the Rays, and we don't watch them play all that much, but certainly it's easy to know the team. They haven't been around, you know, that long, 25 years. They sort of have always been devoid of what you'd consider to be great players, like, you know, really the very best players. Have they ever had the best player in the league on their team? I don't think so. Not even the top two or three.
A team I would describe them as pitching before hitting.
Yes.
Obviously, there was that brief period of time when they had like Carl Crawford and Evan Longoria, and I think there was like one other guy that was...
Wasn't Big Game James a big pitcher on that team?
James Shields, and then he got traded to the Padres. But I re- for the most part, I feel like they've always sort of been known as a pitching and fielding team.
So by WAR, you know, and it's funny because so if you go to Baseball Reference, you can look up any franchise.
I would assume that Longoria is number one.
And that is correct. So Evan Longoria, who we have talked about going hard to believe, but he might be a guy who has a chance at the Hall
Tampa
of Fame.
He might be Tampa Bay's first Hall of Famer.
Maybe. I don't think so.
I'm going to guess Carl Crawford's number
Carl
two.
Carl Crawford is indeed number two. And Ben Zobrist is number three.
He played a bunch of
Tampa.
Years there.
But I don't know that I would have gotten that.
And then you're going to have guys like Chris Archer and
Kiermaier is number four. He's there now. David Price. So he might have had the chance to be the best Ray of all time because his pedigree coming out of Vanderbilt was, you know, this great
and
pitcher.
And he was a great pitcher for them, but then he ended up leaving, and he's sort of just been a fringe guy now for a while.
James Shields is behind him. Carlos Pena. He was a
that was the other guy.
Yeah, big first baseman. B.J. Upton. Kazmir actually is ahead of B.J. Upton. So Kazmir, yeah. Met fans a little sore about trading Victor Zambrano for him all those years ago.
That was such a terrible trade.
It was a terrible trade. B.J. Upton is there. Julio Lugo is the 10th highest WAR all time. And that really kind of tells you a lot. Nothing wrong with Julio Lugo. Just like, you know, he was a baseball player. And Desmond Jennings is number 11.
Ooh, who?
And Chris Archer, you mentioned, is number 12 all time. So they don't go any past 12. And then you go to other teams, they might have 25 or 30 guys there.
Yeah.
But maybe it's only 25 years, so give them a chance because cumulative stat that WAR
guys like
is.
Class now are going to be on there in a couple of years.
But they just lack that sort of franchise player.
The face of baseball has never even remotely been thought to be coming out of Tampa Bay. They've never had a guy that's even been, even Price at his best was never at that level.
He was really
the closest.
And so they did bring in a player who played for the Red Sox and the Yankees and was an all-time, he is a Hall of Famer, ended up going to Tampa, I think was his last
Got
stop.
His 3,000th hit there too.
Right. So he, you know, Wade Boggs, we're talking about, not listed in the top 12 all time, but his going to Tampa was a big deal, and him playing for Tampa was a big deal.
It helped legitimize them
I know what you mean, right? It just like okay, now we need to pay attention because Wade Boggs is on the team.
And he got his 3,000th hit there. It was a home run, I believe. He also completed the Wade Boggs challenge, as outlined in "It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia."
And what would that be?
Drinking the entire 12 pack of beer on the flight from Philadelphia to Tampa Bay.
So he didn't go there until he was 40. I should probably.
I'm pretty sure a 40-year-old Wade Boggs could have done that. I'm just saying.
Okay. So he played there in 98 and 99, and he batted 280. And actually, it's always relevant to talk about batting average and talking about Wade Boggs, obviously. 348 and 400 slugging. And then came back in 99 at age 41, played 90 games. He hit 301 with a 377 on base and a 754 offs. I mean, that's the guy's 41.
That's quality contributor there.
And that's just another reason why Wade Boggs is a Hall of Famer. So
do good hit.
Not the most famous, you know, Tampa Bay Ray, but might be the best baseball player ever to wear a Ray uniform.
Yeah, because I can't think of some other Hall of Famer that's like briefly there might have been one that stopped in there for a year in the twilight of his career that I'm not thinking of. But Boggs, I think, is the highest profile guy that they've had.
Yeah, I think so, too. So, you know, it's not fair to a certain degree. And I guess when we do the Diamondbacks, and they will come up when we get to all the teams that have won one World Series.
Right, the Diamondbacks, the thing is the Diamondbacks are going to be, like, they got their World Series from guys you do not think of as Diamondbacks.
Right, good point. And so the Rays, when they went to their World Series, know that this is a
homegrown Wade.
Yeah, as much as it could be a homegrown team.
That
organizational
that Diamondbacks
team.
World Series win.
Was a bought team.
Yes, you had Luis Gonzalez, but it was spearheaded and won on the backs of Randy Johnson and Curt Schilling. That was a very mercenary World Series. And it worked.
Yeah,
very well.
And so I think the Rays would now, as any team would sign up, you know, to win a World Series.
Yeah.
And it's been tough for them, right? Because I think Glasnow is a great pitcher, and he hasn't pitched now in a season and a half or something like that.
Wander Franco has been.
Yeah, Wander Franco not having anywhere near what they expected after last season. He came out so strong. So,
Granted, I think this year is a year you're probably for him going to chalk up a little bit to injury.
Right, but they have McClanahan.
Yeah, who's been unbelievable.
Right, so
Rosarena. has not been the guy that showed up in the 2020 playoffs, but it was unfair to expect that from him.
Yeah, I still am a little disappointed. I guess I expected him to by now.
See, this is what I kind of expected from him all along. I was surprised he was as good as he was last year, to be honest, because it just seemed so... Guys just don't do that.
Well, he won the Rookie of the Year in 21.
Right.
Right. So that is
good.
Last year.
And
so
he's been good this year.
That is last year. So, but if you look at the season last year, I kind of agree. He was 274, 356, 459 slugging. Ops plus 129, caught stealing 10 times, leading the league, got 20 steals. So he's successful two-thirds of the time. Not terrific. And so that's good for a rookie.
Right. The problem was, is because of what he had done in the playoffs, we came in expecting him to be at superstar level. And you kind of expected, okay, we'll give him a rookie year to adjust. But, you know, we expect a top level this year, and I don't think he's been that.
No, he leads the league in only one statistic, and that's, again, caught stealing. So,
which is not a great stat. One of the few stats you do not want to lead the league in.
So I think, you know, they have the team now in place, much more so than the Diamondbacks, that they... You know, they have a lot of good players, and there would be no reason to think that the Rays are further away next year. They should be right where they are now if they're not going to do it this year. I would say that with a little here or there, they could be a team.
I think
with
the Rays
now,
are the kind of team.
Right in it.
I think if you're the Rays, you have to look at this and go, you don't make any crazy moves at the deadline this year. You go, you know what?
It's not this year.
It's not this year. We got hurt. The Yankees are playing out of their mind. The Orioles are even playing super well this year. Let's just punt this year. Let's not mortgage our future to go bring in some guy to maybe have an outside chance at running into the playoffs when you can just wait for next, because you're not old.
Right, that's what I'm saying. And they've got some young talent, and so, certainly on the pitching staff.
It makes perfect sense to just...
Their relief pitching this year has, like, they always manage to find all these relievers, the Rays, and they come in and they pitch lights out, like Fairchild a couple of years ago. Their relief pitching has not been nearly as strong this year, has not been as lights out.
Right, because advanced stats are a predictive tool. They are not a portent of the future.
So I want to ask you, Bo, about the Rays, and on this podcast, we talked about it at the time. So the World Series a couple of years ago, Kevin Cash, manager, takes Blake Snell out, and they end up losing the game to the Dodgers and then the World Series as well. Kevin Cash is still the manager of the Tampa Bay Rays. Is that a good thing, bad thing, or doesn't matter one way or the other?
It shows that they're not lying about that they are an analytics-driven team, because they took out Snell because it was an analytics decision. And so they're not punishing Kevin Cash for following what their entire line of thinking. Because if you're going to do that, then you don't actually believe in the analytics. You believe in whatever is winning you the baseball game in that moment. So I think...
And were they validated because, like for instance, last season they won 100 games.
Right,
so they're a good team. He's a good manager.
Ultimately, at the end of the day, the only way we're going to limit success generally to only the team that won the World Series. If you didn't win the World Series, we generally don't call that a successful season.
Yeah, and
which really isn't fair.
It definitely isn't fair. And I think if you were Kevin Cash, you have to stop yourself from glinging at Blake Snell right now, going, "Well, see."
Yeah, was I wrong?
See, I took him out because he's not pitching deep into games this season, and so.
So I think if you're Kevin Cash, I think what you have to look at is that if you're a Rays fan and you're a manager, what I've learned is, what's the team like? Mm-hmm. Is the team doesn't seem like they're playing. You know, this is the kind of season where I think if they come out listless at the beginning of next season, then Cash might end up on the hot seat.
Well, and Cash might be the key term when it comes to the Rays, because this is not a team that spends money, right? So just think about a team that is as good as we think they are. And I like this player. He's a nice player to have on the team, but he should be a complimentary player. G-Man Choi, right? So should he be your first baseman, or should you have a thumper at first base who can really help you score runs in a way that they would never go out and spend the money for?
Right. So the problem that is, that actually works against Cash. Because if you're not going to go out and spend the money on a big, sexy free agent signing, well, you could go out and spend the money on a big, sexy free agent manager. That's going to cost you a lot less.
Yeah, but if you've got the same player, and again, the ballpark, we talked about that before, it may make it difficult to attract people to come and play in that ballpark.
Well, the biggest thing is
one of the last turf fields
in the state
in
you're
baseball.
Playing in. That's a big attracting point, is you got to go play in Florida. and you're going to make a lot more money because you're playing in Florida.
No state income tax. Yep. You know, so, you know, people from Toronto in particular, where they're paying more taxes, you know, than the Blue Jays are like, oh, trade me to the Rays. At least I'm going to make a lot more money, even if they pay me the same.
Exactly. So I think at the end of the day, if you're a Rays fan, you would hope that this would be the type of offseason where you go in and you make one or two moves to really strengthen your team. Maybe you go get a first baseman. Maybe you go get some, you know what? The Mets win the World Series and they don't sign Edwin Diaz. Go throw the bag at him and bring him in to be like, okay, now all those ninth inning losses that we had last season, we're not having them now.
It does make it hard if you're the Rays, right? Because you think, okay, Juan Soto's out there. There is no chance that Juan Soto is remotely interested in going to what is a good team in the Tampa Rays. He thinks about the ballpark,
no
the
chance.
Market, going, you
you're
know
out on you're out on Soto. You're out on Ohtani from
right,
the beginning.
Right, you're just not in it on this. And for the fan base, that's really hard, right? Because you're saying
right, but how
we're going to have to always be the little team that could.
Right, but then again, with guys like Ohtani and Trout, like what? Then like fan bases of, you know, 28 of the 30 teams need to be annoyed because basically no one.
Right, most teams are out. Right, that's true. That's true. So, I feel like they had the chance. The only chance this year would be to do what the Mariners did, right, and win 14 in a row out of nowhere and very soon. Then the Rays could say, okay, maybe it is, you know, we do have a chance. But I think that's what it's going to take
and the problem is it's too late to do that because by the time you win 14 in a row, the trading deadline's passed now.
Right, that's coming up real soon. So we're going to see what we got.
I think a team like the Rays will stand pat. I think a team like – I could see a team like the Blue Jays making a move because they're first in the wild card right now. Make a move, secure your spot. You don't have to think about it. One of the teams in the Central for the AL will also be a buyer.
You think?
Yeah. Either the Twins or the White Sox, because they both look at that division as winnable. Or the Guardians. One of those teams is going to think we can win that division, and they'll go out and get somebody.
So the last thing we'll say is, you know, we mentioned in passing and we kind of just touched on it, Evan Longoria Hall of Fame, you know, would go in as a Ray. And I think that would definitely be the case.
Right. So I can't imagine he would go in as a Giant unless it like his own request for whatever reason.
So this is his 15th season. And he's not having a bang up season, older player, whatnot.
No. I know he's not having a bang up season because I see Wilmer Flores playing all
but
the time.
But he does have 326 career home runs mm-hmm. in his 15 years. He's got three gold gloves, only two, however, with Tampa. And he got a gold glove with the
Giants.
No, three with Tampa. His last year with Tampa in 2016. 57.7 career war. And this is where war kind of throws you off because I think his defensive metrics really help push his war number
agreed.
Up higher than it probably should be. Career ops of 121 because the on-base career is 335. Yeah, that doesn't sound Hall of Fame-y.
I think at the end of the day, Evan Longoria is a poster child for the Hall of Very Good.
Yeah, he's an almost guy for sure. But the Rays need somebody in there, and he's the guy that's closest right now.
I think, you know, you might need one of those pitchers. You know, you need Glasnow to stay healthy for 5-6 years and have, you know, a couple Cy Youngs in there. Then he might get it.
I hope he pitches soon.
Me too.
Thanks for listening. Subscribe to our podcast on your favorite platform.
Follow us on Twitter @AlmostCooper.